So I do the TV show. It's called Reality Church. We have guests. It's a Believer's Variety talk show. And we do dances, and we have artists, and we have keyboard and vocals, and we have teachers and testimonies. But the most important thing is to really talk about how your life has changed because you asked for help.
And grace empowers you to see like him. Grace isn't a license to just do whatever. Nobody wants a Jesus that says whatever. See, it's true that God will take you just as you are, but he doesn't expect you to stay that way. The way you are needs to die so you can live. And if we think we have it all together, we're worse off. So I'm like, tell mommy that daddy found God. She's not coming out. I said, you do whatever you got to do to get her home. So she kicked and screamed and complained, and mom came home. I'm like, hey. She goes, don't you hate me. I hate you. She's an atheist, man. She doesn't want anything to do with what I got to say. She's angry. I hurt her and destroyed her. And I'm like, things are going to change. I told my daughter, I put her to bed that night. Things are going to change, honey. I love you so much. Oh, daddy, I'm so happy for you, daddy. I said, I'm going to show you who God is, honey. Oh, daddy, great. Awesome. I'll see you in the morning, okay, before school. Okay, problem. That first night I'm out on a binge. Within an hour, I'm gone. Why? I had no idea what I've given myself to. That first night, I'd become the very thing that I despised my whole life. Hypocrite. That's a dangerous thing. That hypocrisy thing that I couldn't stand. I hated Christians that confessed one thing and lived another. I had become that very thing the first day. Gee, that's heavy. The difference before that night happened than the other night before that, when I was out on the last binge, is I felt horrible about what I was doing. The last time before that seed came in, I didn't care. Like, whatever, this is just the way it is, man. I go home, I expect to get yelled at, it's just the way it is. It's just same old, go through my thing, get done with my drugs, high comes down, goes away, and then I go home, face the trouble, and then another day. And surviving. This time, I can't stand it. I'm high, and I'm like, gosh, and I'm totally, I can't believe it. I go home, and this time, it's like, this heavy. Just, I'm in a bad place. I called Dan in the morning. I said, dude, I went out last night and I did it again. And he said, Todd, let me tell you what Jesus says you are. And he just kept pouring the truth into me. He didn't try to revisit any curses or roots or family. None of it. None of it. All he did was tell me who God says I was. This is what Jesus says about you. And then, you know what, Todd? And this is what else. He says, well, then why am I doing this, man? Because you don't understand. And you need to seek him. Now, what does seek him mean? I don't get it, man. And there was a problem. I couldn't read. I had a problem reading. So all my life, I never read a book. So at this time, I'm like, I went my whole life without reading anything ever. I mean, magazine, maybe a little article or something. But I'd forget what I read, so why read? So I just gave up on reading. Seriously. Like, if you can't read, if you can't understand what you're reading, it's a bummer to try to read. And I found out that it's a major dilemma in the church with the Bible. Christians that have been Christians for 50 years don't read the Bible because they listen to their pastor, and then we wonder where Jesus is at. And I'm not pointing the finger being mean. I'm telling you that Jesus has made a way for us to have a communion with him, a relationship to where he will reveal it to you. The Bible is not meant for your brain, it's meant for your heart. It's not. It's not meant for your brain. You cannot get it here. You can memorize as much scripture as you want. Theologians know the Bible. Yet, it's possible to know the whole Bible, memorize everything, and not walk in anything. Because you can think, because you know it all, that you're puffed up and you think you can quote it, you finish any scripture, yet sit there and chew out your brother and live a complete life contrary because you have not married the Word and the Spirit together and they are not one. And you have no relationship with God. All you have is a theory about God. And the problem is you can incorporate miracles into your life and pray for the sick and have people healed, but still not know who you are. And you can't afford to do that. We need to be in a place of no condemnation, no guilt, no shame. Because if that thing exits your life, it will stop you from ever wanting to do anything that brings it on. And the only way that happens is mind renewal. So I'm in this place, man, and I'm falling again and 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 again, 3 or 4 times a week. So 5.5 months down the road, I go out one night. My girlfriend follows me in town. I lose him. I go down the back street. I pick up some kid from New York City because my dealer wasn't home. I get the drugs in my hand. I have a 1/4 ounce of crack in my hand, different baggies. I tell the kid I'm a cop and read him his rights. I tell him to get out of the car and put his hands on the hood. And when he gets out of the car, I hit the gas and he unloaded a 9mm at me from 10 feet away. And when the gun blasts came out of the gun, a voice came out of nowhere at the same time. And that voice said, I took those bullets for you. Are you ready to live for me yet? Now I'm faced with something here. Way more than anything else. I have a 1/4 ounce of crack in my hand. Gunshots were just fired at me from 10 feet away. Being an ex-Marine, if I shot at you with a 9mm, I promise from 10 feet away, I would hit you with every one of those bullets. But no bullets hit me. And that voice is ringing in my ears. So what do I do with that? I have to get that voice to go away. So I smoke all of the drugs. Problem. Every time I took a hit, that voice would kill my buzz. So all night long, I couldn't get high. And I was freaking out. And I pulled into my driveway, as usual. This time, there is this fear on my life. I'm trembling and don't know what's going on. It's called mercy. When you have an encounter with mercy, your whole life will change. So I go to the door. My girlfriend's in there, slams the door. My daughter slumped over on the couch, passed out. She's screaming, raging at me. My daughter's like, Daddy! Slams the door. I leave. I go out to the car, shine a flashlight around my Jeep. Not one bullet hole in my car. And I went, oh my God. What am I going to do? I went and called Dan. I need help, man. All right, let's do it. So bed opened up at Teen Challenge. I go to Teen Challenge. I went away. I submitted to God. Do you know that you cannot, in your strength and in your strength of Scripture, resist the devil? Do you know that you can't memorize a million scriptures and then just resist the devil? Without the Spirit, you have nothing. All you have is a bunch of knowledge. And knowledge puffeth up. Yet the Bible says that we perish for lack of knowledge. What I'm saying to you almost sounds like don't read your Bible. But I'm not saying that. I'm saying that if you think that faith comes by reading, you didn't read the scripture right. Because faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the word of God. But without the interpreter, without the Holy Spirit, the one that authored that book, you will think that you get it because of your book smarts. And you can't have it. Because he hides it from the wise. Oh, I'm so glad. You have no idea, dude. I mean, I'm so thankful for that one right there. Because like I said, if we could figure it out, we probably will. But you can't figure this one out. Jesus says, unless you become like a child, you'll never know. You'll never know him. Unless you become like a child. So I'm like, yeah. I go into this place. My girlfriend is glad that I'm gone. My daughter is sad because I'm the only dad she has. I go into this thing and I have to enter in for 12 months. So I'm in the program. I go up there. I wake up an hour earlier than everybody else and I'd open my Bible and have no idea what I'm reading. I would. I'd go into a little room called the prayer room. I'd open at 5 o'clock in the morning. I'd just start reading something and be like, oh God, what is going on here? I have no idea what this means at all. Nothing. I mean, like I'm reading and I'm like, and I'm going through the classes all day long and the workbooks and stuff, and I'm learning about God. But this thing about the bullets and this thing about I took those bullets for you is still there. It's not like it's there. It's not going away. It's his love. It doesn't go away. It's his mercy. So I'm in there, and all of a sudden, about a month and a half in, a scripture turns on the lights for me. And it's in James, and it says, if I lack wisdom, ask God, and he'll give it to me. And I'm in there in the prayer room, like, if you lack wisdom. Now, we just read it the day before, and we did like a workbook on it, but I didn't get it. I was like, you can cheat and find the answers and stuff, you know. So, but I'm in the prayer room, and I'm waking up an hour early. I'm talking an hour when no one's looking, because that's where God is. That's where God is. That's where your relationship starts. So this is where I'm at. And nothing's making sense. And I'm praying. I'm saying, God, I got to get this because I have no idea what I'm reading. And every day, God, I have no idea. All day long, God, I have no idea. Help. And then all of a sudden, if you lack wisdom, and I went, oh my God, that's it. I don't have any wisdom. I'm talking like it looked like this. Oh my God, that's it. I'm wisdomless. That's it. I can feel God right now all over me. Right now. And I rarely have it happen, but I realized that I have such a need to know him. And I'm wisdomless and I have no idea. And I was like, you step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart of gold, hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow, here I am to say that you're my God, you're altogether worthy, altogether worthy, altogether
here. This is a little peek at what we've done. This is a finished product of a lot of people's efforts, what's been going on here. But what you see here are four finished ramps that guys, skaters from the community came out and built. We had they had the know-how, we had the manpower, we built it. But this, we opened up, our first night was Tuesday last week. We had over 100 kids show up in the community for the first.
Just in unity and peace. Yeah. There was no, I didn't see anybody like tripping or yelling at each other or anything. So that's a miracle in itself right there. Not a miracle, but it's a miracle. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to have you preach sometime. Will you do that? You are awesome. I don't even need to give a message because this, I mean, what we've seen here is greater than any message or sermon you could ever see where people have come together and we need to be willing to take that step. Now, let me tell you, I think a lot of times people feel like with church, it's like this. Go clean up your life, and then you can come to church. And I think we put that on ourselves, too. I remember making that excuse as a young man. Like, well, no, I'm not ready to give up this or that. I'm not ready to change my life and be one of those perfect people and go to church. And notice Jesus doesn't say anything about that to Matthew because he knows. I mean, think about this. You don't clean the fish before you catch it. Right? You got to catch it first. And God can't, he doesn't expect you to clean up. You can't do that on your own. This is just as much as you can't save yourself, and salvation comes from God as a free gift, you can't change yourself either. You tried. We already failed, right? January 1st came around, made the New Year's resolutions. How many of us did an epic fail on that diet, right? You know, so you can't change. Genuinely, I believe people can genuinely change. But I really believe that it's only through God's power that we can be transformed. And it starts by responding to his call. And it doesn't mean I get my life together perfectly before I come. I come first. Okay? You need to come to God first. Jesus, Isaiah 55 verse 1. This is God just saying, come all who are thirsty, come to the waters. You who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. It's not something we can earn. It's not something we can buy. It's something that we have to come to God. We got to take that step. Matthew got up from the tax booth and he followed. And he was radically changed. He was radically changed. The third thing I want you to write on your notes too is this. That, you know, he didn't stay that way. Right? God said, come as you are. But the second part of that is, you don't have to stay that way. And this happened because Matthew allowed God to renew his vision. You can write that in your notes. This is the next thing I want to challenge you with is you need to allow God to renew your vision. I'm not kidding. This is my dream in life. I'm going to get a couch. I'm going to cut the back legs off of it. That will make it a lowrider couch. It's even more comfortable. I got the Frito-Lay. We'll put it by the beach. I got my lowrider couch. It doesn't rain that much in Southern California. We'll surf. We got the couch, we can sleep there, we got the Frito-Lays, hook up, we're good. I'm not kidding you, you think I'm joking, that was my dream in life. And it wasn't until I came to know the Lord, and I came to him, and then he began to renew my vision, and I'd be like, oh, maybe I'll go to Bible college, right? I didn't even think of being a pastor, I just was like, okay, Lord, you want me to do this? I'll do this, you know? And so, it was just one thing after the next, I just said yes, I just didn't say no. And that's how he renewed my vision for my life. And he wants to renew your vision. You know, he doesn't want us to stay stuck on the lowrider couch. God has a bigger plan for your life than that. You know, you've seen those. Maybe some of you guys, you're living on the lowrider couch right now. And you came here because we got pancakes. Dude, that's awesome. But, see, but the thing about God is he doesn't do it from the outside. Religion paints the outside first. And we try to, you know, and we just try to make it look good on the outside. We did a lot of that here. Like, we're going to paint, we're going to make it, you know, but you can't just do that. You're not going to genuinely change if you just change your behavior and try to white knuckle it and be good. That doesn't work. God knows that. So he's able to change your heart. That's where it starts. It says in Ezekiel 36, 26, I will give you a new heart. I will put you a new spirit in you. I will remove from you the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. So many of us have just been beat up by this world, and you've been hurt or you've been lied to, and you believe those lies, and it affects your soul, and it's like, oh, and then you try to fix the outside, and it doesn't hold together because the inside isn't right. And only God can do that. Only God can take my heart that's a heart of stone and transform it to something that's soft and pliable that can actually love and be loved. Amen?
Anybody happy like you believe that God is good? Does anybody on this side of the room believe that God is really good? How about this side of the room? Anybody believe in God? Wow. One of my favorite prayers to pray in the morning is, God, surprise me in just how good you are today. You know, that prayer will get you in the best kind of trouble. Oh, man. Do you know, right now is the best time to be alive. If you believe that, just say amen.
Amen.
Right now, today, when you and I are living, right now is the greatest time ever in history to be alive. What God is doing all across the globe right now is unprecedented. It's amazing. And the great thing is, he isn't just doing it through the polished preacher, through the man of God, through the person who's been to Bible school, who has a theology degree. He's doing it through anybody who is hungry. He's doing it through anybody who's desperate. He's doing it through anybody who's willing. You don't have to be perfect because he is perfect. You don't have to have it all together because he does have it all together. It's not about what you've done or what you haven't done. It's about what he's already done. This kingdom of heaven thing that we're pursuing is way simpler than we ever made it out to be. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Fall in love with the Holy Spirit and you become dangerous. Then it gives God pleasure to touch one life. Say amen. That we get to do the work of the kingdom, and it's not about how much we've trained, it's not about how much we know, it's not about how much we've studied, it's about recognizing that he's good, that he's in love with people, and that it gives him pleasure to do it, and he's willing to do it through me just because I'm willing to let him do it. What is better than seeing Jesus win? You're on the right team. We have permission to act like it. But he never fails. He never fails. He never fails to come through. And in fact, the harder the situation is, the happier I get. Why? Because I know just how good he is. Even in all my silliness and my quirkiness and my goofiness, he doesn't just put up with me. He's not waiting for me to get polished. He's not waiting for me to get another degree. He's not waiting for me to memorize enough scriptures. Before any of that, he doesn't just put up with me. He likes me. You just changed the odds. You and Holy Spirit is a majority. At that moment, I can grab onto my own ability. I can grab onto my own righteousness. I can grab onto my own strength. But aren't you glad that the Bible says it's not by strength or by might, but it's by his Spirit. And so in that moment I choose, God, I can either accept this intimidation, this boulder of intimidation that's rolling downhill at me, or I can let go of myself and I can rise up above it and I can step into who you are and who you say you are. And I can begin to declare your goodness. Say, he's good. And yeah, you. that you are living in the greatest revival the world has ever known, ever seen, ever experienced. It's happening right now. Do you know the only difference between what's happening right now and what's happened in the past is it's not isolated to one city? You know, more Muslims have come to the Lord in the last 10 years than the previous 1,000 years combined. An entire village, an entire community will all have the same dream, the same night. Jesus will come to them and reveal himself in a dream, who he is, the scars on his hands and the whole thing, and they'll get saved while they're sleeping, having this interaction with Jesus. So they find out the entire village all had the same dream. I mean, there is documented cases where it's not just a village of like 30 people. Thousands of people all saved with no missionaries. Nobody's ever brought the gospel in there yet. When the missionaries do show up on the scene, the people start preaching the gospel to the missionaries. I was at Starbucks a couple years ago. I love this story because it hits this point home. I was at Starbucks, I was doing a little discipleship meeting with one of the students, and there was a couple sitting a couple tables down. We were sitting outside. It was a nice sunny day, and I kept looking over. I just kept getting drawn to this couple. It kept happening while I'm having this conversation with one of the students, and finally, I just like, excuse me, I just got to go talk to this couple real quick. And so I get up and I go over there, and I said something really profound. I said, excuse me, but this might sound unusual, but God was just highlighting you to me. Do you need prayer for something? That was pretty profound. You might even be able to do that one. I said, is there anything that you might need prayer for? I don't know. God just keeps highlighting you to me. I don't know what it means. And the lady said, well, you're from Bethel Church, aren't you? I said, yeah, how'd you know that? She said, we're not from this town. She said, we're just driving through. We stopped here to get a sandwich and a cup of coffee. We've been in town for approximately an hour and a half, and you're the third person that asked if you could pray for me. She told the first two people no, but she says, I think something's up. I better let you pray for me. That's what she said. So I had no word of knowledge for her. I had nothing. All I know is that God kept highlighting them. And so I went over and I said the most profound thing I could think of. I said, God's highlighting you. What do you need? And she said, I better let you pray for me. So as I'm talking to her, now all of a sudden a word of knowledge comes. And I turned to the lady. I said, you have pain in your left hip? It goes down your leg? And she said, yeah. How'd you know that? I said, well, like I said, God's highlighting you. I said, are your legs off balance by any chance? And she goes, I don't know. I said, well, just right where you're sitting, just put your legs up. So you're sitting outside tables in Starbucks, right? I have her sit, their back flat up against the chair. I pick her legs up, and one leg is an inch shorter than the other. Is he good or not? I turned to her husband and I said, you're going to want to see this. We prayed, and right there, her leg grew out at the table in Starbucks just like that. It shot out. She went, oh my God, I felt that. And her husband's jaw went. I said, get up and try your hip. And she got up. She's like, there's no pain. Oh my goodness. She said, I've had this for so many years. I've walked off balance. She's all, I haven't felt straight in so many years that now I feel crooked. her and her husband rededicated their life to Jesus right there at the table in Starbucks. God is so good at his job, he needs less help than we think he needs. And our job is this. It's increasingly this, that we learn how to invite him to come and get out of the way. Psalms 51, verse 11. David cries out to the Lord, "Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me." "Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you." Wow. But I began to recognize that Jesus himself actually is healing. Jesus isn't just healing. Jesus is also provision. He's also protection. He's truth. He's wisdom. He's love. He's forgiveness. He's justice. He's all these things. Is that true? That's why he has over 300 names just to attempt to describe himself. But in all that, when Moses met with God in the burning bush and God told him to go into Egypt and deliver his people, and Moses said, "Who should I tell him that sent me?" What was his reply? He said, "Go and tell him, Moses, that I'm the deliverer." No. If he had told Moses that, would it have been true? Yeah. But would it have been the whole truth? He said, "Go and tell them that I'm the provider." That's true, but is it the whole truth? "Go and tell them I'm the Savior. Go and tell them I'm the King of Kings. Go and tell them I'm unconditional love." Those are all truths, but none of them in themselves can describe the full nature of his goodness. The nature of his goodness is so expansive that the only answer that he can give to adequately describe himself is, "Go and tell him that I am who I am." Wherever you can feel his presence, he is not just the healer, he is himself by nature healing. Let me ask you this. In the presence of God, at the feet of Jesus, is there cancer in his presence? Is there sickness in his presence? Is there disease in his presence? Is there pain in his presence? Then his presence by nature is healing itself. Meaning anytime that you can become aware of the presence of God, healing just became available. Ha ha ha. The kingdom of God has just come near to you. You know, the reason that God even does the healing is so that people will have an encounter with the revelation of his love for them. That people will understand that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That it's available. That he's near. That he's madly head over heels in love with them. That's the reason that God does healing, and that's the reason that I personally am passionate about healing. Is rise up and walk. You know what happens when you pray for one person, whether they know the Lord or not? You stop somebody on the street, you pray for them in the lobby of church or the supermarket or the gas station or the bank or at your workplace or wherever you are, you pray for somebody and they've had pain in their knee. They haven't been able to go up and down stairs for 15 years. And you pray for their knee and all the pain goes. They're going up and down the stairs and they're like, "No, you don't understand. The pain's really gone." And you're like, "I know, because God's good." And they're like, "No, you don't, it's really gone." You ever have people try and convince you that they got healed? Because the pain is gone. They know you didn't do it. And they know that he didn't have to do it if he didn't want to. The entire gospel message. You know, in that one moment, what happens in somebody's heart, what explodes in their heart, the revelation of his goodness and his love, it could take you 3 months to teach them that. I said, "Do you know this Jesus?" And she goes, "Well, I don't know. My boyfriend talks about him sometimes." She said, "But when you prayed for me, I felt something come all over my body. It was so warm." She goes, "That was the presence of God, wasn't it?" I said, "Yes, it was." I said, "Now you know what he's talking about." She goes, "I do." I said, "Do you want to know this Jesus for yourself?" She says, I do. And so she gave her heart to the Lord right there at the bar, in the restaurant, at the airport. Yeah, March of 2009. Almost 2 years ago, Rick was healed of stage 4 esophageal cancer. Yep. It definitely wasn't me who prayed for him. It was a 12-year-old. Because there is no such thing as a junior Holy Spirit. We have children in the healing rooms that have full-fledged badges, authority to pray for the sick, to see God do the miraculous, and they know it. And they're dangerous. Rick wasn't sure what he thought of the whole thing, so he said, "I don't want anybody laying hands on me." He's all about it now. But 2 years ago, he wasn't quite sure. He's like, "That stuff is weird. Those people are weird. So I will go." His son had to convince him to come. He said, "I'll go, but nobody's touching me." And you can't tell because he's sitting down, but Rick's about 6'4". He's a big guy. Used to be a biker. And so when they said, when the son said, "Okay, he's willing to get prayer. He just doesn't want anybody to touch him." The prayer team looked at Rick and said, "No problem." And so the prayer team was following directions, and they're standing a little bit away, and they're just praying, but without touching him. They're just releasing God's presence. And I believe this is right, but he just got comfortable enough to close his eyes. You know, like, and then he finally closes his eyes, right? And here comes this 12-year-old boy who didn't get the directions that the adults got. And just comes floating through the room, just releasing the presence of God, just whacking people in the goodness of God. And he just comes by and he just puts his hand on Rick's chest, and Rick goes, bam, it hits the floor. He's out for 45 minutes. When he wakes up, he's got a pillow under his head, one of those cute little prayer shawls up over him. When he woke up, he asked his son, he said, because he's so unaccustomed to this, he said, "Son," he goes, "Wow, so how long was I out for, like 3 or 4 minutes? Son said, "No, Dad, you were out for 45 minutes. And he turned and saw the pillow under his head. He goes, "Wow, what are the odds I would have landed on this pillow?" Rick met Jesus in a living way that day when he was out in the Spirit. Jesus came to him and revealed himself, told him who he was, invited Rick into a full relationship with him, and now Rick is dangerous. Everywhere he goes, he freely gives what he freely receives. And people get healed of all kinds of things, deafness and blindness and cancer and paralysis and you name it. It's amazing to watch God's hand on his life. I think our second year there, this girl who was deaf in one ear because she had no eardrum in that ear, got prayer and her ear popped open. She could hear perfectly out of that ear. We go back the next year, and she walks up to me and says, "Do you remember me?" She's 12 years old. I said, "Of course I remember you." She said, I can still hear perfectly out of my ear." I said, "That's amazing. That's so good." And again, we see deafness all the time, so that's not extraordinary, or it is extraordinary, but it's not unusual. She says, "I've been back to the doctors 5 or 6 times since you guys were here last." I said, "Really? Why?" She said, "Because they can't figure out why I still have no eardrum, but I can hear perfectly out of my ear."
My neck, because I'm constantly in the chiropractor for this. And I had my hands on my hip, and she put her hand on my arm, and my arm was feeling fine until she put her hand on it. And then I'm feeling all this pressure on my arm. I had dislocated this elbow. It had stayed dislocated for a month and I didn't know it. I just had a lot of pain. And I have permanent damage in this elbow.
Wow.
I can't bowl. And when I was feeling this pain in my arm,
wow,
this pressure, the Lord's like, "Go bowling."
Wow.
I have no pain in
Come
my
on!
Elbow.
Somebody go get a bowling ball right now.
Wow. He's the God of breakthrough. That means he has to have something to break through. Cancer is really good at fleeing. Tumors are really good at dissolving. It's what they do well. Deaf ears are good at popping open.
Praise the Lord.
I think we should. Let's just give Jesus praise right now. Come on! Jesus, you're amazing! You're amazing! You're amazing! Father, you're amazing! Oh, man. I am getting so excited. I might just do my happy dance. Today's the greatest day to be alive right now, because God made himself available. When Jesus died on the cross, the veil was torn from top to bottom, meaning that you and I have access to his presence, we have access to the throne of his goodness, we have access to his grace, we have access to his goodness. And the stars don't have to align. The ties don't have to be right. Things don't have to be perfect. You don't have to be perfect. I don't have to be perfect. He's already perfect. He already did it all. He said, "Boldly come before the throne of grace." He said, "You have access anytime." He said, "My goodness is here waiting for you. Here I am with open arms. All you have to do is say yes and lean in."
Wow.
You know what that means? That means that you have the ability to be aware of his presence right now. Now, how much of God do you and I have right now? You know what's really amazing? Is that God isn't just a good theology. God isn't just a good idea. God isn't just a good theology. God's a person. Wow, and whatever you focus on grows. Whatever you turn your attention to increases. So the moment that you recognize the measure that you're carrying, the measure increases. Maybe that's how we go from glory to glory. And then once you recognize the increase, it increases some more. So how much of God are you carrying right now? Revival was God's idea, and using you and using me was also his idea. You know, for God to move through you and doing amazing things and see a whole bunch of people get impacted by the kingdom and have their lives changed and get rocked and to get healed and to get saved and get baptized in his goodness, that was his idea. You didn't think it up. You just get to partner with his idea. Wow. Anybody want to do that?
Yeah.
Oh, Oh, good, me too. The unity. When the bride comes into the recognition of who she is corporately, wow, all things become possible. Wow. Say, I was saved by grace. This God is a God of grace. He moves in grace. Sometimes we talk about the person of God, and all of a sudden it's like, that's scary. Wow, there isn't such thing as the fear of the Lord. But even the fear of the Lord is beautiful. But the person of God comes by grace. Wow. He's the Prince of Peace. That you actually are more aware of God than you think. Anytime the atmosphere begins to shift and you feel peace come into the room, it's because the person of God is moving in with His presence. Wow. And then we can choose to minimize that. Like, oh yeah, worship was sweet. Oh, I think she started to get it. We can minimize that by going, yeah, worship was sweet. But whatever you focus on grows. Or we can recognize that He is the Prince of Peace, and the peace that I was feeling was Him moving in with His presence, and I can begin to recognize, wow, that's not just worship, but the person of God is coming in the room. Doesn't God in Matthew 6, when He teaches us how to pray, the one place where He actually takes time to actually teach us how to pray, hallowed be Your name, Your kingdom come, Your will be done, where? On earth, as it is where? In heaven. So if you're in Christ Jesus in heavenly places, if you're born again, you're a new creation, you're seated in Christ, but yet it feels like you're sitting in the chair right there, what does that actually mean? It literally means that you have dual citizenship. That you're both here and there at the same time. That's what it means to become a new creation. You're not bound by the old confinements. You're like, how's that possible? Well, it's possible because you're a new creation. Not just to understand heaven, but to be aware of heaven, to actually access heaven, to be the access point between two worlds. Jesus teaches us how to pray, Your will be done, where? On earth, as it is where? In heaven. You're seated both here and there at the same time. So where do you think the first place heaven is going to touch earth through? You know, and if you have all, which is the truth, but sometimes it's theological truth, sometimes it's understanding, sometimes it's a concept, sometimes it's an idea, but do you know that as a church, for way too many years, we've made the mistake of trading the person of God for the idea of God? That you just get to host Him, and then on you, He is God to the world. And once that happens, there is no such thing as a hard place, because you showed up, God likes you, that means He's with you, He's on you, and He's going to be God to the world. And He only created the difficulty so He has something to break through. He gets glory.
We want to bless you today. We want you to feel like God is there, ready to answer your prayer. So we thank Him that He died on the cross for our sins, that He rose from the grave, all that our sins would be paid for, and that we could have eternal life. There is a choice to make while we're alive. Either choose God or choose life without Him. But I would rather spend eternity with Jesus in His heaven, because anything without Jesus would be hell to me. And so you can have eternal life. All you have to do is ask Him into your heart and ask that your sins be forgiven. Because as soon as you forgive others, then you are able to get in on God's forgiveness.
My amazing son, my precious daughter, You are my beloved child, in whom I am so pleased. I am your father who adores you. I love you. I've always loved you. I don't love you because of what you can do for me. I love you because you are mine. Not for any other reason. You are mine. I love you with a passionate, strong, and immovable love, and I will never, ever change my mind. I not only love you, but I really, really like you. I like what I made. I like who you are. When I made you, you were my dream fulfilled. I delight in you. I celebrate you. I dance over you, and I sing my songs of pleasure over you. I'm very, very proud of you. I'm thrilled to call you mine. You're doing so good. You're doing so much better than you think you are. Keep going, my child. And I want you to know that you measure up. You are enough. Even if others have told you otherwise, my voice of truth is the only voice that matters. And I think you are absolutely astounding. You're my success story. I'm not done yet. Just watch what I do with your life. My child, I bless you. Not reluctantly, but wholeheartedly, I give to you my father's blessing. It's my heart's desire to bless you. So I bless you with my favor. And I bless you with my goodness. I bless you with my grace. My grace is doing for you what you couldn't do for me in a million years. I bless you with my peace. And I bless you with my joy. I bless you with the full inheritance of my kingdom that's yours through my son, Jesus. Everything that's mine is yours. I hold nothing back from you because you are mine. You are my chosen prince. My chosen princess with full access to my kingdom. My royalty is in your blood. I want you to know that I'm on your side, no matter what. I'm totally for you, always. I want you with all of my heart. And I will have you as my very own forever. My beloved child, my heart is your home. Enter into the joy of my heart and my kingdom. Not someday, but right now.